Hey everybody, welcome in. My name is Ernest and I'm going to teach you how to cook. Today on the show, it's one of my favorites from growing up in Oklahoma. It's beans and rice. I'm going to show you a really cool one pot way to do this. It's absolutely delicious. Coming up in the extra helping, it's a snack that everybody seems to have really caught on to in the past 10 years in a really big way. It's hummus, but we're doing roasted red pepper hummus. You can make it yourself and it's better than anything you could buy at the supermarket. So let's get going. It's really good food today. It's really simple and I'm excited to show it to you. This is Eating in Bed. Growing up in Oklahoma, I soon learned to appreciate just a pot of beans and some cornbread for dinner. It's a staple in the South and the Mid-South and maybe in many other places. When I actually moved here, few people understood what it meant to just have beans for dinner. But as I have lived in New York, there's a lot of great different cultures up here, and one of them is Latino culture. And in Latino culture, whether it's Mexican or otherwise, there's an idea of beans and rice. Of course, you get that when you go to Mexican restaurants and things like that. And a lot of people will just cook beans and then throw some rice in at the end. But I've actually figured out a way to do it together, and it's really pretty tasty. Let me show you what we're gonna be using today, first of all. Now, I've already soaked a pound of pinto beans in water overnight. Just rinse them off in a colander first. Pick out any half beans. I might have missed a few, it's okay. Put them in a bowl, cover them with water about 2 inches, just tap water, leave them on the counter overnight for at least a good 12 hours. If you can go almost 24, that's even better. The beans will puff up, they'll have a little less gas that way, and they plump up really well when they cook. When you're ready for them, just drain them off, rinse them really well because they've got a little dirt and debris on them, and you should be good to go. So I've already done that, the beans are ready. Let me show you what I'm using in the beans. Now, a lot of times when people cook beans, they might just stick with just the beans and a ham hock, but I like to, you know, put a little extra stuff in. So I've got two small onions here. You can use white, you can use yellow, you can use purple, which is a red onion, it doesn't matter. These are pretty small. As you can see, they fit in my hand here. If you have one bigger one to use, that's fine as well. I've got two carrots here. I've already kind of scrubbed them a little bit. I'm gonna chop those up. I have two huge cloves of garlic that I'm going to put in there. And then just one stalk of celery. I'm not huge on celery, but it does add a great flavor and it actually has a little bit of a sodium flavor to it. It's got some natural salt in it. So that's really good to use in here as well. And then I have 1 tablespoon each of garlic powder and onion powder. Lastly, of course, I have the pork hocks. It's also called ham hocks. These are only about $3 and $3.50 in the store, not very much at all. We're just gonna be using one of them. It adds a great bit of thickness and flavor to it. And actually, we're not even gonna salt this a lot when we start. This is going to add a lot of flavor. Now, if you wanna stay vegetarian with this, instead of using a ham hock, use a little 4-ounce container of tomato paste. Put that right in when we assemble all the beans here. It thickens up really well, adds a great bit of flavor to it, of course, and you can stay vegetarian and not have to put the ham hock in it. But today, we're using one of these ham hocks. If you put another one of these in a freezer safe container, you can freeze it for later use. That's fine, just give it a good 24 hours to thaw before you pull it out and use it for whatever else. So here's all the vegetables. Let me just set some of this stuff out of the way, get going a little bit at a time. Grab one of my knives, which I love the knife magnet. Gonna get chopping on these things here. Actually, I'm using my Lodge cast iron Dutch oven that I used before. And cast iron is really great at distributing heat evenly. It heats well, it heats often, and it stays heated. So while I'm chopping, I have it over here on another burner. I'm actually gonna pull up a nice medium to low fire underneath the empty pot to get the heat going on it and get it heated up. Gets the seasoning kind of activated. You're okay with that. You're not gonna burn your pot. Let's give it a nice little dice here. And you don't even have to dice. You can just kind of leave it half moon size like this. Just be careful not to cut yourself there. Oh, that last piece is good. Actually, and if you want, you can actually cut these half moons in half down the center like that and make them quartered. And you're fine that way too. Onions are hard to chop sometimes. So, you know, whatever is easier is better for me. All right, now with the carrots, of course, you just want to take the end off of those, toss that out of the way, and be really careful when you're cutting a carrot because the knife can get away from you, the carrot can pivot, and you might end up chopping your finger off as well. So I kind of lay into it like that and cut it in half. Kind of find where the carrot naturally stops moving. There we go. And then just gently kind of go into it. And with the heel of your hand, just push your knife into it, just like that. And then there you go. Now, you could cut this again and quarter this long ways, but I don't mind it like this because, again, it's going to cook down and be a little bit more bite size worthy. So there we go. All right, so with the celery, even if you have leafy bits up at the top here, use those. But I take my knife from the top and just gently run it down the middle of the rib. If it's really big, you can quarter it. I took the white end off down here, right at the root area. You don't want that. It can be a little bitter, but everything else, including if you have leaves up here, has really great flavor. So use every bit of it. I go a little bit smaller of a dice on celery. And of course, with your garlic, you put it under your knife, give it a whack, and it splits right open. And then you can just gently kind of pinch the skin off of that. And there you go. But I'm going to put these in whole. They will soften up and just dissolve into the beans. So when it's done and you're kind of stirring them around, you see that garlic clove kind of just sitting in there. You can just press with your spoon, press it up against the side of the pan, and it'll just dissolve in there. The garlic flavor is a little softer that way. I love this Dutch oven so much. As long as you season your cast iron after every time you use it and you don't use soap on it, your cast iron will last you lifetimes. You will be passing it down to grandchildren, trust me. So this is heating up. I'm gonna put a little bit of olive oil right in here. Just a bit. I mean, a couple tablespoons, but we're working here. Also, preheat your oven to 400 degrees. This should take about 2 hours, and then the last bit, we're going to put the rice in just the way we normally would, with a little extra water to compensate for the rice. Finish it off about only 17 minutes instead of the normal 20 in the oven, and we have beans and rice. It's going to be nice and thick and just delicious. So while that's warming up, let me show you what we're doing with the ham hocks here. Let me just cut this open. Like I said, you can freeze one of these if you want to for later use. This is just part of the leg. And you can see it. There's a lot of fat on it, and it's not really anything that you could normally just kind of eat if you wanted to, but because there's this fat and pork is cured, there's a lot of really great flavor in this that can be rendered down and used. And, you know, anybody that's ever had beans knows that there's a big ham hock in it. You can actually do it when you make black-eyed peas. We're doing that, I think, next week. We're making pork chops and applesauce and some black-eyed peas, and we're going to use a ham hock in that as well. This is already cooked and cured a bit, but we're going to put this in and actually just let the fat start to render down a little bit. A lot of this is going to disappear into the beans and thicken up, and you're just going to have the actual meat, and there's a bone right there that you're going to have left over as well. We're just going to kind of sear that almost. We're searing the fat on either side just for a few minutes to kind of get it going. Then we're going to put the onion and celery and carrots in there and get that going with it as well, and just kind of start everything going. And then we're going to get the beans going. So this is starting to sizzle just a little bit. Use your tongs, work it around. You can see that it's already starting to darken here a little bit. I'm not out to burn it or anything like that, but we're in it to get a little bit of the fat coming off of it. So as you can see, our vegetables are cooking down. We don't need them to cook down all the way. We're not trying to caramelize anything. The ham hock is cooking well. I kind of just kept turning it. You can see where it's a little bit more brown over here and on top. And I had it on the bottom there a little bit as well. So I'm going to go on this side. I've just kind of kept it off to the side of my pan. I used the tiniest bit of salt, just a couple of cranks of the salt mill. I think salt kind of inhibits beans when they're cooking and they don't plump up the way you would want. Same with black-eyed peas or something like that. So I try to keep very minimal on the salt, just enough on here to pull so they can help pull out their natural water and their liquids. You don't need everything really rendered down or softened up. So the carrots might still be a little bit hard to the teeth if you were to bite into them. I am gonna add my garlic powder and onion powder right now. Just give it about a minute or so on there to bloom, as they say, the flavors to open up. Stir that in. Let me show you the beans. The beans are just about twice the size when you plump them up like this, when you soak them overnight. I had them in a bigger bowl. I drained them, let them dry a little bit, after I rinsed them off. So this is a pound of beans. It's a little bag of beans that have pretty much doubled in size at least. And I'm gonna start off with 4 cups, which is one of the boxes that you get from the store, of chicken stock. Now, if you have homemade chicken stock, of course, that's better. Like they say, store-bought is fine. But this is 4 cups I'm gonna start with. When we do the rice, if you have more chicken stock or vegetable stock that we're gonna add in the liquid, you can use that or just use water. It's really not gonna dilute anything at that point. Now, what I do is I actually put a little bit of stock in here. It's kind of deglazing the pan. If you have any kind of sticky bits on the bottom from those seasonings or the vegetables or whatever, this is a good time to pull them up with that little bit of stock. It's called fond, and there's lots of flavor in that. There we go. Now I'm gonna go ahead and add the beans in. Just pour them right in, every bit of it. Now, if the 4 cups of stock isn't enough, feel free to supplement with more stock or water, but let's start with the rest of the stock here. Look at that. I think I'm gonna add a little bit more water to this. I'm gonna start with about 2 cups in my container here. You wanna cover the beans, yep, the whole 2 cups. So about 6 cups to start of liquid. Give it a little stir. So I've got it over a high heat. You're gonna bring it to a boil and then turn the fire off, put the lid on it. We're gonna put it in the oven. One thing that you don't want to do is use tomato product in your cast iron. Tomato, because of its acidity, can really strip your seasoning. One of the best things you can do with your cast iron the first time you get it is cook bacon in it or some kind of meat product that's got animal fat in it. Even though you season with vegetable shortening like Crisco or something like that, when you cook something with animal fat in it, it really helps season your pan naturally over time. And cast iron can become nonstick if you keep it seasoned correctly. Don't put it through the dishwasher, don't wash it with soap. Just keep seasoning it after every time you use it. So if you're doing this and you're doing a vegetarian option and doing tomato paste, putting tomato paste in it, use an enamel coated cast iron or some other kind of oven safe pot. Now, if you just have the stainless steel pots with those black handles, if you take some foil and double wrap those handles and the handle on the lid as well, you can put that in the oven up to about 400 degrees and they won't melt. You'll be okay. If you put them in there uncovered, they're gonna melt and you have a problem. But if you just cover them with foil, cover every surface with foil of those handles and then the knob on the lid, you can be fine using your stainless steel in the oven as well. And you might drop to about 375 just to be on the safe side. You might have to cook about another 15 minutes, 20 minutes, but you'll be all right. But if you have cast iron, that's even better. Okay, so this is just starting to boil. You can see a few bubbles just start to pop up. We don't need it at a rolling boil. So I'm gonna go ahead and put my lid on it and put it in the 400 degree oven, center rack right in the middle, leave it for about an hour and a half. You can go in there at about an hour and a half and check it, look at it. You can taste one of the beans. They should be, not hard to the teeth, like you're not doing al dente or anything. You're probably gonna go about another 15, 20 minutes at least. You want them just before they're done, just a few more minutes. That's when we're going to add the rice. So we're gonna go ahead and get this in. I'll see you in about probably, I'm gonna go an hour and 45 actually, and we're gonna see where we're at with this. And then I'm gonna show you how to add the rice and finish it up. Okay, stay tuned because in the extra helping, I'm gonna show you how to make what seems to be really popular snack lately, roasted red pepper hummus. It's really easy to do and you can change up the flavors in hummus any way you want to. It's gonna be better than anything you buy in the store. So stay tuned, we're gonna take a break. I'll see you after the hummus and we're gonna check those beans and rice and get to eating.
Enjoy the good feeling again.
After my car wreck, I went for months with nagging pain in my lower back. It hurt to do even the simple things. Finally, I went to the chiropractor and was amazed at the results. I'm a pleasure to be around again.
The Doros Chiropractic Clinic is now offering a free initial spinal exam to determine if chiropractic treatments will benefit you.
Enjoy the good feeling.
Over a high heat on your stove, place the bell pepper directly on the grate. If you don't have a gas stove, you can do this under the broiler in your oven. Turn the pepper every couple of minutes until all sides are blistered and blackened. This could take up to 10 to 12 minutes. Once the pepper is blackened, place in a covered container for at least 30 minutes, up to an hour. This lets the pepper steam. After the time has passed, gently peel the outer skin off the pepper. Get rid of all the black char on the outside. With a knife, cut the top off, then cut the pepper open. Remove the ribs and all of the seeds. Next, drain chickpeas through a strainer over a measuring cup. Save the liquid, we are going to use it in a few moments. In a blender or food processor, add your chickpeas, your pepper, about a half a cup of tahini, 2 cloves of garlic, 1 shallot coarsely chopped, the juice of half a lemon, 1 teaspoon of salt, 1 teaspoon of fresh ground pepper, and a pinch of red pepper flakes. Add little bits of the reserved liquid that you strained off, about a tablespoon or two at a time. Blitz with your food processor or blender until everything starts to come together. Keep processing on high until you get a nice, smooth paste. Taste for additional salt and pepper or hot sauce or lemon juice as needed. Here I'm emptying the tahini into small ramekins for individual serving. You can top with a little bit of extra roasted red pepper, chopped green onion, parsley, or any other herb that you like. This recipe makes about 2 cups. It's homemade, it's fresh, and it's delicious. Enjoy! Well, the beans are done. As you see, we put the rice in about 15 minutes before it was due to be totally finished and added 2 cups of water to that. You know, you gotta compensate for that. And now it's done. So let's take a look at the beans. Mmm, that looks delicious. Everything's kind of calmed down from cooking. You see, it suddenly got really thick all of a sudden. Of course, the starch in the rice really helps that along as well. And you want to make sure to add that 2 cups of water or, you know, chicken stock or whatever in there because you have to compensate because the rice is going to soak up so much liquid. So you have to put that in there to compensate for that. But look at that. That's just wonderful beans and rice. That ham hock has still got some fat, some of it rendered out. That's good. Just kind of leave it in the pot for right now. See, there's a little bit of meat coming off of it right there. Can you see that right there? A little bit of tasty meat. It's pork. How bad could it be? So that's it. This is the part where, you know, we didn't put a lot of salt in it, so you really want to give it a little bit of a taste right here just to see where you're at with it. Oh, it's really good. But I think I'm gonna put just a little bit of, this is some Hawaiian black salt. You can use any kind of salt you have. Just a little bit in here. few turns of the screw. Give it a nice little stir. Oh, it's just lovely. To plate it up, I have some chopped leeks over here that I just cut up the lighter green parts down to the white part. Be sure to rinse the leek out. I cut it down the middle. Dirt gets in all those little folds and grooves, and you don't want to be eating dirt. So right in a ramekin here. A couple of nice spoonfuls. And then some leek on top. You can't go wrong with that. That is beans and rice. It's really that simple. I know a lot of people will cook the beans and then just throw some rice in afterward that they've already cooked. But when you cook it together like this, the rice takes on the flavor of the beans. Of course, it adds more substance, and it's just absolutely delicious tasting. Let's give it another quick taste now that we added the salt to it. Mmm, perfect. If you don't have any leeks for top, you can use a little bit of green onion on there. My father actually used to put a little dollop of ketchup in his beans. I don't know where he got that from, but it's good. I've done that before. So you can leave the ham hock in there for right now. This is really delicious. It's an easy meal. It's one of those things you just kind of put in the oven and you don't think about it. If you love beans and rice or any part of this video, give it a thumbs up. Oh, and if you love hummus, how delicious was that? Good Lord, that was tasty stuff. We make it all the time now. But give the video a thumbs up, share it with a friend, leave a comment below if you have any extra little tips that you do for beans and rice and what you would like to see next. I am going to go have some beans and rice. My roommate is hungry. I am hungry. We are going to go eat. So enjoy your dinner. I will see you next time. Thanks for watching.